It's good to see y'all. Welcome to Community Bible Church. It's good to be together worshiping our Lord. He is worthy, and we are going to give him a fraction of the praise that he is worthy of, but we are going to offer our praise to him this morning. So let's take a moment, as we do just about every week, in silence to collect our thoughts and to prepare our hearts to worship the Lord together. We're going to read from Ephesians chapter 1 as we're called to worship this morning. So let's stand as we behold and remember the glorious grace of the gospel. The scripture says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace which he lavished upon us, in all wisdom and insight making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory." This is the power and the grace and the work of the gospel. That God has taken undeserving sinners like us and has given us every spiritual blessing in Christ. And he has transformed us from rebels against the holy, worthy God of the universe to worshipers of the holy God of the universe in Christ. That's what the gospel is all about. And so this morning, as we get to commission a missionary and we think about the mission that God has given us and the way that our worship fuels our mission, we want to start by remembering the beauty and the glory of the gospel, rejoicing in the love of our God and the grace of our God that he has poured out on people like us. So let's sing together.
Nazarene, and wander the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side. Knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died. You rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. King of Kings.
Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that we can worship the Trinity this morning. We thank you, Father, that you've revealed yourself to us through Jesus Christ, and that we can worship him this morning because of what you've done in the hearts of those who have believed, Father. Changed our lives, Father, through the blood of Christ. And we thank you for that. We praise you this morning for the opportunity we have to worship with one another, but to come to worship you. And God, this morning we come to you in great need. Father, we're truly a needy people. We still struggle with sin. We thank you that we have the power over sin, but we realize that we don't have ultimate power yet. And we just pray that your Holy Spirit would strengthen us and reveal to us the sin that lies within us, and even when it's not obvious. And Father, we thank you for the forgiveness of sin that you've promised us through your word. We pray that we would take hold of that and recognize, confess, and repent. Father, truly you say that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and we praise you for that. And God, this morning we come to you with great need, Father, as a body of believers. Father, we pray for Community Bible Church of Orange Park. We pray that you would help us to stay united and with one purpose, and that is to expand your kingdom. Father, truly the only reason the sun came up this morning, Father, because you haven't saved everyone that you're going to save. And help us to be focused on that one thing. And God, we pray this morning as a church, Father, we thank you for Jazz and her desire and obedience to follow you to the mission field. And Father, we lift her up in a great way and just pray that you would just use her mightily for your kingdom's work. And Father, help us to be diligent and vigilant about praying for her and lifting her up to you. And Father, we thank you for all the churches that are meeting all over the country, and specifically even in our own community, Atlantic Beach, Sunrise Community Church, and their pastor, Alan Cagle. Father, we pray for that congregation this morning. We pray that as we pray for ourselves, that your name would be highly lifted up, and that your word would be preached with power, and that lives would be changed because of Jesus Christ. Father, we also lift up governmental leaders and local leaders, Father. We pray that you would use them in your sovereign plan. Father, help us to trust in your sovereign hand over all things, but also encourage us to stand for your truth, the truth of your word, and the righteousness that you so desire. And God, as we continue this morning, I pray that you'd help us to worship you in spirit and truth, and that you would use the words and the songs to encourage us and to encourage us to lift you up to a world that desperately needs you. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Well, we still are not passing a plate, as you guys know, as we take an offering each week. But there's a couple ways that you can still give. We've got a box mounted on the back wall. You can drop a check in if you want to give with a physical check. You can also give online, and you can follow a link from our website or our app if you want to do that. But if you're a guest today, we just want you to know that we're not after your money. We're not asking you to give any money to us, nor do we want you to feel obligated to give money to us. This is something that we do as members of Community Bible Church to partner together for the mission that Christ has called us to. But if it is your first time with us, we would appreciate if you would take just a minute to fill out the connection card that's under one of the seats in front of you. There's a little clipboard with some connection cards on them. So if you would fill that out with as much information as you are comfortable giving to us, you can drop it off at the connection desk on your way out today. And we've got a little gift that we want to give you to thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Matt?
Got to get everything up here. Jazz is making me do everything. All right, we are going to have a commissioning service, as many of you know, for Jasmine Kiernan. We call her Jazz around here. And so I'm going to have her come up and say just a few words in just a moment. Before that happens, I just want to call out to you the fact that this is the 5-year anniversary for the Braders being with us at our church. Anna posted a picture this week of, I feel like I caught my mic on something right when I got to sit up. Okay, I think I'm better now. Sometimes it loops around my chair and I try to get up and it that stops me. These are things you're supposed to think, not say out loud. I feel good now. It is their 5-year anniversary. Anna posted a picture of their moving van and everything, leaving Wisconsin to come here. And we are have all been greatly enriched and blessed, at least most of us have. there's always people that don't like you, so even you, Joseph. My list is much longer, but Joseph's is shorter. But we have been greatly enriched by their ministry to us in so many ways. Pastor Joseph put so much work into our worship services, believe it or not, it's just not randomly throwing a dart at the song list and saying, oh, we haven't sung that one in a while, let's throw that one in there. He prays over our service. He tries to select a variety of places for us to be guided by Scripture. We are reciting creeds and confessions and prayers together sometimes, and he's just greatly enhanced and made what we're doing here that much more meaningful, and we're so thankful for that. Many of you have had the opportunity to meet with him for discipleship or for various things, and so he has enriched your life in that way as well. And I'm sure many of you have benefited from that. Anna, who doesn't like to be called out at all, serves in a lot of ways behind the scenes with our children. And of course, she enables Joseph to be able to do many of the things that he does here. She frees him up to be able to do those things. And so we are just so thankful for them. Can you pretend like this is a surprise?
Absolutely.
It was a surprise the first service. So if you could go like this, that would help. We know that they are going to planning on going to Charleston in the fall for the weekend, and we've got a gift here that hopefully makes it longer than a weekend. There you go. That was the moment. That was the moment I was looking for. We want to make it easier for you to go. Hope you have a longer trip, and we are really thankful for both of you and Asaph as well, all of you. So. Okay, I'll be preaching in just a few minutes to kind of direct our thoughts on how churches send missionaries. But we've talked to Jazz a little bit, and there are some things that I want her to share with you before she goes. So, Jazz, I have your microphone ready. I have your stand set up. Done everything you've asked me to do. It's your turn.
Hi, I'm Jazz. I would like to give a shout out to my stagehand. Thank you so much. For the record, it was just my own doofiness that I forgot the stand in the last service. And he stepped up graciously. So in 2018, actually, it doesn't feel like it was that long ago, but it became clear to me that God might be calling me to do full-time missions. And at the time, all I had was enthusiasm. It was the same year I got an opportunity to go to Brazil, and I got to talk a little bit more with missionaries about how it looks to live on mission. I came back and I started looking for missions organizations to get involved with. Some of them were recommendations, some of them were organizations I already knew a little bit about, and some of them were organizations that I just Googled, and then ended up combing through their doctrinal values and core values to make sure that like things lined up, and the things that didn't line up weren't, to use a John Sweat word, salvific. So I ended up becoming an appointee with an organization called Pioneers, as most of you probably know now. Pioneers has a widespread reach, and there's a lot of opportunities, as well as their dedication to reaching the unreached and empowering the local church, which was a lot of elements of link-up ministries in Brazil, a lot of the things that I really enjoyed and thought were important about their organization. Pioneers gave me a long book list of things to read up on, but I still knew I needed some training. Pioneers let me know of an opportunity to work with an organization in New York City called International Project, which is a missions organization dedicated to reaching the, I think it's about 70 unreached people groups in the downtown area. And ironically, the program was called EQUIP, which is exactly what I was looking for. So for the last 6 months, I've been going around and meeting with members of our church, as well as friends and family outside of the church to raise support. So in the Navy, we say in order to succeed, you need to show up on time in the right uniform. And if you've been in any branch, I'm sure you've heard something similar. So showing up, being willing and ready is one of the most important ingredients of success in the Navy and in the military, and I suspect it's also one of the most important aspects of doing missions, being a missionary. On time, God's timing, there's really not much more to elaborate on that. And then in the right uniform. So our group, the Jesus and Board Games group, has been reading through Ephesians, and one of the things we've been talking about is putting on and taking off. In the military, we call it doffing and donning, but I think that's actually the right English word. I don't think we made that one up. I'm just going to read a passage from Ephesians 4. It comes from Ephesians 4, 20 through 23. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on a new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. That actually extends to 24, so I lied, I'm sorry. So just the importance of putting off old self and putting on new self so that you can be better equipped to do what God has called us to do, which is to share the good news of Christ. And doing that by studying Scripture, by meditating on Scripture, by being in the body of Christ and being around other believers that are trying to achieve the same mission. But those are the three pieces, being showing up on time, in the right uniform. So here we are. In a few weeks, I'm going to be living in New York for a year to try and reach the unreached people groups in the inner city, and I'll be supported by a lot of the faces that I see here today.
I sounds like I could have used some military training, because I show up most of the time. I'm not usually on time, and I'm pretty much never in the right uniform, but that's all good. No, all joking aside, though, I love that that Jazz kind of has this military analogy to our mission. You'll hear sometimes people talk about the church militant. That means the church on mission. Like, God has formed us as soldiers in an army fighting a spiritual war for the souls of lost people. And the combat looks different, and the weapons look different than the ways that we think of war. In fact, it's quite the opposite. Instead of killing people, we're actually inviting them to experience eternal life. But there is this militant aspect to the church's mission where we are recognizing and acknowledging and moving out like we're in war against the powers of darkness. And so I appreciate the way that Jazz kind of brought that in. There's sayings, popular sayings like worship is the fuel of missions, or that missions exist because worship doesn't. And so what we're doing in here right now is, as we worship Jesus, as we turn our eyes to behold the glory of Jesus, as we set our hearts and our affections there, is create, as the Spirit works through the Word, as the Spirit works through that vision of the glory of Christ, he creates in us a passion for more people to know and worship Jesus. The reason we go out with the message of the gospel, there are many, but the ultimate reason that we go out with the message of the gospel, the ultimate reason that we are a church militant and on mission, is so that Jesus gets the glory that he is due. And we get to play a part in that. Whether or not we go halfway around the world, whether we're praying for missionaries who are going halfway around the world, and we're sharing the gospel with our neighbors and our coworkers and our family members and the people within the four walls of our house, we are called, and we have the incredible privilege of participating in this grand mission and in the fulfillment of God's plan of redemption for people from every nation and language and tribe to be gathered around the throne of heaven, praising him, because he is the one who's worthy. And so I'm going to read from Revelation chapter 7, and then we're going to sing a song that says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let every nation bring its honors to the King. One roar of harmony eternal." That's what we're about. That's what the mission is about. So let's stand, and we're going to read this heavenly vision. That's the ultimate goal of the mission that God has called us to. "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" We get to join that song right now. And we get to testify to the reality that we exist so that more and more people bring more and more glory to the only one who's worthy of our worship. So let's sing.
You made the starry hosts, you traced the mountain peaks, you paint the evening sky with wonders. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea. All nature testifies your splendor. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing his greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice, you heights and all you depths, from furthest east to west. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. You reached into the dust, in love your spirit breathed. You formed us in your very likeness, to know your wondrous works, to tell your mighty deeds, to join the everlasting chorus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing his greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice, you heights and all you depths, this east to west. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let symphonies resound, let drums and choirs ring out, all heaven hear the sound of worship. Let every nation bring its honors to the King. A roar of harmonies eternal. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing his greatness, all creation. East to west, you distant burning stars, all creatures near and far, from sky to sea to shore, sing out forevermore. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
And then, Lord, would you work in us to make that our heartbeat and the cry of our souls. As we hear from your word, would you just grow a fire in us to see everything that has breath praise you, to see more and more people come to repentance and faith in Jesus so that more and more people are giving him the glory that he deserves. Use us as a small outpost of your church, militant, to be about your mission and to see people from every nation and language and tribe come to know and adore the one who is worthy. Don't do this for our name's sake. Do it for your name. Do it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
Our text today is going to be Acts chapter 13. So if you would like to turn there now, go ahead and do so. If you don't have a Bible with you and you'd like to follow along with us, you should be able to find a Bible in one of those chair racks that are there in front of you. And Acts chapter 13 is on page 921 of those Bibles. The mission statement of our church is to develop worshipers of Jesus who are growing in the gospel and going with the gospel. We've been talking about how the name of Jesus is worthy of worship this morning. We've talked about the phrase that's often used, worship missions exists because worship doesn't. And one of the main jobs of the missionary task is to take the gospel so that people who are not worshipers of Jesus become worshipers of Jesus. So they join that heavenly scene that we see in Revelation chapter 7 of people from every people and tribe and nation and tongue and language gathered around the throne to worship the Lord in the new heavens and the new earth forever. We talk about developing worshipers of Jesus who are growing in the gospel and going with the gospel. And it's important that we define that word gospel. Gospel is the word gospel refers to a message. And the Bible tells us that all of us were created by God for His glory. We exist to bring God glory. We exist to worship and serve our Creator, and yet through nature and our own choice, we do not do that. We sin against our Creator. We rebel against our Creator. But the gospel is the good news that our Creator does not leave us in our sins. If He was to leave us in our sins, we would be separated from Him forever. We would remain what the Bible often refers to as children of wrath, people who are under God's wrath and separated from Him eternally. But God, in His grace and His mercy and kindness, chose to send His unique, one and only Son to give Himself so that we could be redeemed, so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be shown grace, so that we should receive mercy, so that we would experience the new birth, so that we would have hope. And He accomplishes this through the giving of His one and only Son. God's Son, Jesus, takes on flesh and then offers Himself as a sacrifice for our sins on the cross. The good news of the gospel is that Jesus does not remain in the tomb in which He is buried, but 3 days later, He is raised miraculously and gloriously, and He offers forgiveness of sins, mercy, grace, peace. He offers even to bring us into God's own family so that we are no longer children of wrath, but children of God. And He offers this free gift of salvation to anyone who repents of their sin and puts their faith in Jesus. Maybe your friend brought you here to church this morning, and you're wondering why they dragged you out to a church service on this Sunday. This is why. This is what they wanted you to hear. We're going to have an invitation right here at the beginning of the service. Sometimes you go to a church and you have to wait all the way to the end. Well, you don't have to wait to the end, and you don't have to come forward. Jesus commands all people everywhere to repent and put their faith in Him. And we encourage you, if you have never heard the gospel in that way, if you've never known it or understood it, if you have never put your faith in Jesus, then we want to call you to repent and believe the good news of Jesus right where you are this very morning and be saved. But our mission statement is to grow in this gospel and go with this gospel. You see, we believe that the scriptures teach that the gospel is not simply the entrance into the Christian life. The gospel is not something that we grow out of, like you might grow out of an old pair of pants. The gospel is not something we grow out of. The gospel is something we grow deeper into. The good news of what Jesus has done ought to increasingly be shaping every single aspect of your life. From the words that come out of your mouth, to the actions that you choose to do and to not do, to your motivations, to your value system, to the way that you spend your time, the way that you spend your money, the good news of what Jesus has done ought to be renovating us from the inside out and completely reshaping us. And so that's why we say that part of our mission is to develop worshipers of Jesus who are disciples, who are growing deeper into that gospel and being changed by it. And one of the things that we believe is that as a person grows deeper gospel roots, that should not turn us inward. It should actually turn us outward. Meaning that the church and God's people should not be a cul-de-sac where everything just kind of dead ends. But rather, as we grow in the good news of the gospel, we ought to have an increasing desire to see that good news go out, that we would go with the gospel. And so, that means a couple of things for us as a church. It means, first of all, that each one of us is intended to be a participant in the Great Commission, which means that every single one of us is a missionary. The vast majority of us will never leave our vocations aside to go to another country to serve as a foreign missionary, but Jesus commissioned all of his disciples, and all of us are disciples. All of us are followers of Jesus. And so as we grow deeper into the gospel, that should turn our eyes outward to see the family members and friends and neighbors and coworkers and people that God has providentially placed us by so that we can live as missionaries among them. But not only are we intended to be participants in this great commission to make disciples, but it also means that we intentionally are involved in going out into the world with the gospel to reach people who desperately need to hear it. There are people who have never heard the name of Christ. There are people, though they have heard the name of Christ, there is no content behind that name. They do not know who he is, as the Bible has revealed him. They do not know the good news that I just walked through with you at the beginning of this message today. They don't have any idea about those things. And so our desire is for them too, that there would be people in the farthest flung reaches of the globe who would hear that gospel and repent in their sins and believe. What we are seeing this morning, what we have the privilege of doing this morning, is an outgrowth of something that we have been praying for several years. We have been praying that God would use us, that God would call out from among us people who would want to go. People who would raise their hand and say, "Here am I, send me." And we have begun to see the answer to that prayer because one of our own, Jazz, wants to go, has said, "Here am I, send me." As Jazz mentioned in her remarks, she went on a mission team to Brazil back in 2018. I was with her on that team. She was asking the missionaries that were there in Brazil all kinds of questions, building some relationships with some of those folks. She was considering whether she would stay in the Navy and just make that her career, or whether she would forsake the stability of that career to go to another place with the good news. And obviously she has chosen the second option, to leave that stability and to go and to walk down a path that even right now at this moment is not abundantly clear where it ends. Now, in just a few minutes, we're going to talk about the role that the church plays in this, and we're going to see this church at Antioch here in Acts chapter 13, which we've talked about before. We're going to see it as a model for how we ought to send missionaries. But I want to make a few points about Jazz and about what she's doing that my end goal is that it hopefully normalizes what she is doing. So let me just walk through four things about her. Number one, the first thing I wanted to say about her is that Jazz is a normal person. And I mean that in the most non-insulting way possible. She is an extraordinary person in many ways. And those of you who know her know that that is the case. But Jazz is a regular person like me and a regular person like you. And that's important for us to note, because when we think of missionaries and when we think of foreign missionaries, because many of us have had a churchy background, we've had stories told of missionaries who have done these crazy things. You know, there have been people that wanted to kill them every day, and they've been around cannibals, and there's all kinds of stuff that happens, and all that stuff is true and inspiring to us. But what it sometimes does is leads us to believe that the only people who do missions work in other countries are people who do stuff like that. When in reality, the vast majority of foreign missionaries are regular people like us who have, as Jazz referred to it, the gift of availability. They've said, I'll go. Secondly, Jazz doesn't have it all figured out. I mean that in the most uninsulting way possible. But the truth of the matter is, she doesn't even know where she's ultimately going to land. She doesn't know what country she's ultimately going to find herself working in. In fact, God may not lead her to another country in the end of the day after all. We just don't know what God is going to do. God hasn't spoken to her in a dream to tell her where she's supposed to go, that he's capable of doing that. He has not spoken to her in an audible voice telling her where to go, though he's certainly capable of doing that. But what Jazz has done is come to him with a willing heart, and she's just started with desire, and she's just looked at her options. So one of those options was going to Brazil for a week, going to another country, talking with the Brazilian Christians who are there in the work that we're trying to do, and partnering with those Brazilian Christians and trying to reach an unreached people group there. She's been talking to the American missionaries who are there in Brazil. She's taking inventory of what it is that she has and how God has wired her. So she's got a Navy background and she's in the reserves. So if she stays in the reserves, she can keep her health benefits and serve while she has her health benefits. And exploring whether that's something that she can continue to do. She is, in God's providence, single. And so has been asking the question, is perhaps God directing her to go to a place where really women are the only people who can work with women? If you're thinking of predominantly Islamic countries, they have cultural rules preventing men from having a lot of interactions with women. And so women minister to women and men minister to men. And that's something that she's looking at. Jazz is the kind of person who doesn't need everything to be just so. Her Navy career has prepared her well for that. And so she's saying, maybe I should go to a place that's a little bit harder, where it's not as comfortable and there's a smaller number of people who can go to a place like that. We don't know where God is ultimately going to send her, nor does it matter right now. My point is simply, there's not something unique that she's doing that you can't do. She's just taking inventory of how God has wired her, the circumstances, the opportunities that he has given her, and asking how those can be used in the mission. In the third place, she's doing everything she can to prepare while she waits. After she got out of the Navy, she did EMT training so that she could get certified there. She also took an HVAC course, actually. And I offered this to the folks in the first service, but she's not leaving for New York City yet. And so if your AC unit is acting up, you might give her a call and she can come over and charge it up, get that up and running before she goes to New York City. But what she's trying to do is she's trying to gain skills that may be useful somewhere else. She's looking for ways that she may be able to support herself if she has to. She's looking at the possibility of going into a country where you have to have some sort of reason to be there that benefits the people that are there. And so she's preparing. And as she also said in her testimony, there's books that she's reading and things that she is doing to prepare for this while she waits. Fourthly and lastly, she's submitted to the process. We believe that churches ultimately are the entities that send missionaries. And so churches partner with missions agencies to be able to do that. Missions agencies have the know-how to be able to evaluate potential candidates, to be able to interview them and find out where what areas they have that are strengths, what areas that they have that need to be shored up. Missions agencies, because they do this all the time, help them determine what kind of support they're going to need. And she has submitted herself to that process. She's the kind of person that just wants to go do it. And yet, she's restrained that part of herself of just going and doing it so that she can make sure she's equipped, which is why she's going to New York City for a year to work with people there. That's part of the equipping process. And so I say those things to you to say, yes, there are extraordinary people that we leave about, we learn about, the extraordinary people that leave on the ship and wave goodbye to all their family and friends saying they'll never see any of them again. And we've needed those people in history. But the vast majority of people that are out on the foreign mission field right now are normal people like me and you and Jazz. So that leads me to what I want us to consider in the rest of our time this morning, and that's this. What role do we play in sending her? What role do you play in sending her? And I want to use as our model for this the church at Antioch. One of the things that stands out to me about the church at Antioch in Acts chapter 13 is that it is a predominantly Gentile church. It's a predominantly non-Jewish church, which means that very early on, as the gospel begins to spread, as the gospel forms a believing community there in Antioch, that church immediately embraces responsibility for the mission and sends people out to reach people even beyond their city. Let's read verses 1 to 3 of Acts chapter 13. The Bible says, "Now there were in the church at Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, a lifelong friend of Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' Then, after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off." I want you to notice what was happening when the Spirit set Paul and Barnabas apart for the work that God had called them to. The church was worshiping and fasting. And one person writing on this passage says that this occurred in the context of what is likely congregational worship. As we gather together each week as a church family to see the beauty and the glory of Christ, that should create in us a thirst and a desire so that we want other people to taste and see that He is good. We want other people to find the living water that we have found. Worship fuels mission. We will never be passionate about spreading the glory of Jesus if we have not been captivated by the glory of Jesus ourselves. As long as it is a thing that we have become used to, it is a run-of-the-mill thing that we are going through the motions, then we are not going to have a passion to see that glory spread. But when we are weekly, both in corporate worship and ourselves as we meet with the Lord each day, as we do those things, it ought to give us a desire to see others know Him. Worship is the furnace that fuels the mission. Now, I want us to see three things that were involved in this sending this morning. The first thing that they do in the sending is they spend time in prayer. When you and I become passionate about making the glory of God known among the nation, our prayer lives are going to reflect that. There's going to be a shift in our prayer lives so that our prayer lives are not just our wish list of the things that we want. They're not just our prayer for help in our circumstances, though those things can be good things to pray for, but our prayer lives are also consumed with seeing the glory of Jesus spreading. So our goals in life are aligning more with God's goals in life for his own glory and how we fit into it. Throughout Acts, we see the vital role of prayer. In Acts chapter 4, when the church first encounters opposition, the very first thing that they do is gather everyone together to pray. And so prayer ought to be our heart's expression of longing to see God do what he has promised to do. We're praying for what he's promised. And here is an example in the New Testament of what that kind of prayer sounds like. From Colossians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. The Bible says, "At the same time, pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak." We see in this sample prayer from Paul that one of the things that we ought to be praying for is opportunity. Open doors are opportunities. Now, in praying for open doors, we are not, that this is not passivity. We are not partnering together to send Jazz to New York City to sit on a park bench in Central Park and hope that someone comes up to her and says, "You look like a Christian. Could you tell me the gospel?" Now, God does things like that all the time. But we're not sending her to New York City to sit on a park bench and just wait. We're praying for open doors. We're praying for opportunities. And we're praying that she would recognize those opportunities, that she would seek those opportunities, that she would take advantage of those opportunities. We want to pray that God would be right now, even as we speak, preparing people, sending his Spirit ahead, preparing people for the moment in 3 months or 4 months or 5 months or 6 months when they speak to her. Because this is not something that we can do on our own, is it? I mean, think about how preposterous it sounds to go to another country, maybe a predominantly Muslim country, and say to people who are culturally and ideologically committed to Islam, "Jesus says, repent and believe the gospel." That is a fool's errand. Unless God's people are praying that the Spirit would open hearts to receive that message. And you know what? The Spirit does that kind of stuff all the time. There are people committed to other cultural and religious ideologies deeply entrenched that they have lived with, are as familiar to them as the air that they breathe. There are people all over the world, all the time, putting their faith in Jesus right now. There are people becoming Christians as we speak because faithful people have prayed that the Spirit would go ahead and do what only the Spirit can do, open eyes. And so we need to pray that the Spirit would open eyes of the people that she speaks to. But with open doors and with opportunity comes opposition. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 9, "For a wide door for effective work has opened to me." Yes! "And there are many adversaries." Both of those things were true at the same time. And we sometimes look at if there's adversaries, that must be a closed door. Because surely there wouldn't be opposition if God was in it. Man, if God's in it, you're having opposition. The more God's in it, the more opposition you're going to have. She doesn't know what kind of opposition that she is going to face, but something that we don't talk about very often in the West is something that is true whether we talk about it or not. And that is the reality of spiritual warfare. Satan hates what we do. He is aligned against God and his purposes. Whereas our desire is to see a multiplicity of worshipers throughout this globe so that the new heavens and the new earth are populated with people who will worship God forever, his purposes are running counter to that. He wishes to bind people and chain people to their sins, to keep people in darkness, and he will attack, and he does not play fair. What might she encounter? We don't know. Circumstantial difficulties, health problems, conflict on the team. I mean, you name it. There are any number of difficulties that she may face. There are going to be wide and effective doors open for her, but there are many adversaries. And so as we pray for opportunity, we must pray for her that God would bolster her and gird her up as she experiences opposition. So we pray for opportunity according to Colossians chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. But we also need to pray for clarity. In 2 Corinthians, the Bible speaks about this message that we have, this gospel message, being contained in humble jars of clay, which is what we are. And one asks, how could these jars of clay even contain the gospel message, much yes, articulate it in a way that people respond and believe? And yet God uses weak, ordinary, run-of-the-mill Christians like us to communicate that gospel message, and then he uses the Spirit to open eyes to make that communication of that message effective. So we need to pray for Jazz as she's there. She's going to be learning cross-cultural tools that will help her not only in this situation, but as she goes into her next place of assignment. We need to pray that she would speak the truth with clarity. We're almost done here. But the second thing I want to point out, you notice that the church did, is they sent the team off with fasting. Fasting is a demonstration of what is most important to us. Jesus once said that his food was to do the will of him who had sent him. Fasting is not a way of getting God's attention so that God sees you skipping a meal and says, man, they must really be serious about this. It's not a way of manipulating God, but fasting is a way of us feeling those physical pangs of hunger and transferring those to our spiritual need and the spiritual needs of others. They remind us that there is something that we need more than food. There's something that we ought to hunger for more than our next meal. And I'd just like to encourage you, pick a meal this week and fast that meal, breakfast, lunch, dinner. Pick a meal this week, fast, and use the time that you would have eaten, use it to pray along these lines that we've talked about for her. Thirdly, we see the church supported them. The church lays their hands on them, which is an act of commissioning, of sending. And of course, this commissioning and this sending necessarily involves support. The church at Antioch, no doubt, was financially supporting this as well. And there's a point that I want to make to you that's very important this morning, and that's this. Our work is not done at the conclusion of the service. What can happen is we can walk out of here and say, man, that was such a nice service. That was so meaningful. and then forget about jazz for the rest of our lives. Now, I'm putting a fine point upon that, but that happens. Our work is not done because we've sent her. I mean, imagine, I don't know if you've ever visited the Space Museum down wherever it is. Lower. This is why, never mind. Okay, so the Space Museum, wherever it is down south, you've seen the control room, if you've been there, where they, where all these people worked, all these NASA people worked to send these rockets into orbit. And we've all seen movies where they send people into space, and it's this big thing. It's super tense. Everybody's sweating and moving around. They're tapping on their computers. They've got their headsets on. They're doing the whole thing. And when finally that rocket gets out of the atmosphere and it makes it into space, everybody's high-fiving each other and cheering and clapping. And imagine if everybody then just took their headset off and was like, "See you tomorrow." And now there's this rocket floating around in space, and they're supposed to do all their space stuff while they're out there, and everyone's gone. That's the equivalent of what can happen when churches send and then say, "See you later." The church at Antioch, we know, because we'll talk about in just a few moments, they received these missionaries to report back. The church at Antioch sends these people off. They support these missionaries. And we are, in a sense, mission control. And we cannot abandon our post. We cannot abandon our responsibilities. The Baptist Missionary Society was formed in the year 1792 by a small group of pastors who were concerned for India. And I've told many of you this before, but there's a phrase here that I want to introduce to the vocabulary of some of you who haven't heard this, because we say it with some frequency. But these Baptist pastors would gather together on a regular basis to pray that God would open up India as a field, that people would become Christians in India, that churches would be formed. There are many Christians and churches in India this very day, due in no small part to their efforts. But as they were discussing, only one of them actually went. His name was William Carey, and many of you have heard of him. But one of the men who was there for these meetings wrote it down and described what happened at one of these meetings. He says, "Our undertaking to India really appeared to me on its commencement to be somewhat like a few men who were deliberating about the importance of penetrating into a deep mine which had never before been explored, and we had no one to guide us. And while we were thus deliberating, William Carey, as it were, said, 'Well, I will go down if you will hold the rope.' But before he went down, he, as it seemed to me, took an oath from each one of us at the mouth of the pit to this effect, that while we lived, we should never let go of the rope." Our job, if she goes, is to hold the rope. Andrew Fuller, one of the men that was part of those groups, never had a chance to go. But he faithfully, through many trials and tribulations of his own, held the rope for William Carey the entirety of his life. We want to hold the rope for her in prayer and support, and letting her know that we haven't abandoned our posts at Mission Control. She may be gone, but she's not forgotten. We want to support her in every way that we can, because we are looking forward to hearing what God does. Acts chapter 14 tells us that this missionary team came back to Antioch. In verse 27, it says that when they arrived, they gathered the church together. They declared all that God had done with them and how he had opened a door of faith to the Gentiles. And we want to hold the rope, looking forward to the day when she comes back and tells us all that God has done. And we pray that God does great things through her. So at this time, we've divided her prayer team that she's gotten together. We've divided her prayer team into two parts. We had some in the first service, and we're having some here in the second service. So if you are part of her prayer team here in the second service, come up if you can now. We're going to have her stand right here where she doesn't want to be, front and center. And I'm going to ask you to kindly lay hands on her. I'll come down here. Everybody get to a place where you're close. You can be in the front around her too. Well, this is a bigger prayer team than I thought. It was this big in the first service as well. All right. Everybody that wants to touch her, you can. If you are touching somebody behind her, it's kind of flows. But what we want to do now is pray for her and the work that God has called her to do. Let's pray together. Father, we believe that Jesus is worthy of glory and honor and praise. And we believe that it is worth leaving things behind so that we can go and make him famous. And so I pray that you would use Jazz to make the name of Jesus famous. We pray that you would give her gospel opportunities. We pray that there would be people whose hearts you are working in even now, so that when she meets them in a few months' time or in a few weeks' time, so that when she meets those people, their hearts have already been prepared to receive the good news. I pray that you would help her as she is undoubtedly going to experience opposition. The Bible tells us that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this age. And we believe that Satan is real. He hates what we're doing. And so I pray that you would thwart his opposition, that you would thwart his attempts to drown out the light. We pray that you would help her to speak the good news with clarity. We pray that you would help her as she is in New York City for the next year to learn cross-cultural skills that will help her not only there, but in future ministry opportunities that come. And I pray that you would receive glory, that jars of clay that are weak like these could be used to communicate a glorious message. Lord, I know that you intend not only to do things through her, but that you intend to do things in her. That you want to use all things to conform her to the image of Christ. And so I pray that as she embarks on this new stage in her life, as she embarks on this new path, that you would supply all of her needs. That you would use all of these things, the good, the bad, and the ugly, to conform her to the image of Jesus. You don't need her, but you delight in using her. So I pray that you would. Lord, I pray that our hands as a sending church would have rope burns on them because we've been holding tightly and holding hard. I pray that you'd help us to be faithful to pray for her. Help us to be faithful in supporting her. Help her to know as there's a whole body of believers who love her and are for her. Lord, we look forward to a day when she returns and recounts all that you've done. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
We're going to have an opportunity to say goodbye to Jazz a little bit more personally tonight after our mission briefing. We're going to have a reception and kind of a send-off for her. So our mission briefing tonight is at 5 o'clock, just by way of reminder. We have a lot of important things to talk about in relation to our mission, in relation to what we are doing as a church, what Christ has called us to as his church. And then we'll go for about 45 minutes or an hour, and then we'll have a reception for Jazz. So if you're a member, we would love for you to make it out to that, out to the mission briefing tonight, both to hear kind of the update of what is going on here and to be able to send Jazz off one more time. But we called a little bit of an audible late in the week, this week in the service, as we were actually going to sing Psalm 150 that we sang right before the sermon at this spot in the service. But as we were talking about the sermon and how the whole service was sort of playing out, there's another song that we were planning to teach you guys later this year that just seemed way too perfect to pass up. And the song is called Worthy of More. And I think as we sing it, you'll understand why we felt like we needed to end this service with this song. But I'm just going to highlight the chorus to you. It says, we give you glory, but still you are worthy of more. In adoration, we sing your praise. Let every nation with heaven proclaim that all the glory is yours, but you are worthy of more. That is exactly what we've been talking about this morning. A vision of the glory of Jesus drives us to invite more and more people to give him more and more glory, because we will never give him the glory that he's due. He is due infinite, endless worship and glory. So I'm going to sing the chorus. You guys sing along as you feel comfortable. Let's stand. I'll sing the chorus once, and then we'll sing the song together.
Sing hallelujah, praise to the Lord. We give you glory, yet still you are worthy of more. In adoration, we sing your praise. Let every nation with heaven proclaim all the glory. Glory, glory is yours. You are worthy, worthy, worthy of more. Oh, the sweetness of your grace. To feel you move and see you save. We give you all the glory, Lord. But you are worthy still of more. And all the earth will sing your praise. In every language, Jesus' name. Lifted high around your throne. Until you come, Lord, we will go. Until you come, Lord, we will go. Sing hallelujah, praise to the Lord. We give you glory, yet still you are worthy of more. In adoration, we sing your praise. Let every nation with heaven proclaim all the glory. Glory, glory is yours. You are worthy, worthy, worthy of more. Here I am, an offering. Lord, I give you all of me. So take my life and have your way. Let it glorify your name. Let it glorify your name. Sing hallelujah. hallelujah. Praise to the Lord. We give you glory, yet still you are worthy of more. In adoration, we sing your praise. Let every nation with heaven proclaim all the glory, glory, glory is yours. You are worthy, worthy, worthy of more. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord of all. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord of all. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord of all. Everything I have, everything for this, that Jesus is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, praise to the Lord. We give you glory, yet still you are worthy of more. In adoration, sing your praise. Let every nation with heaven proclaim all the glory, glory, glory is yours. You are worthy, worthy, worthy. All the glory, all the glory, glory, glory is yours. You are worthy, worthy, God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise
Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts.
Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. Go in the grace of our Lord.